everyone, it's Roo from the King's Roost, and today I'm going to show you how to make homemade beer. Now, traditional home brewing is typically done in 5-gallon batches, requires 2 burners, a couple of big pots, strainers, funnels, siphon tubes, a lot of equipment and a lot of different ingredients, and most of all, it takes like 3 to 4 hours of precision and focus to keep an eye on what you're doing. I'm going to show you a really cool kit that we have at the store that makes 2 gallons at a time and only takes a half hour to get started. And in no time at all, with very little extra equipment, you're going to have your own delicious home brew. The heart of the 2-gallon brewing kit is this conical fermenter. A lot of the equipment that you need to buy separately for traditional home brewing is incorporated into this design. So the kit comes with your conical fermenter. It's cone-shaped, it has a tap, it has a pressure release up top, and it has a temperature gauge right on the side that comes with it. So a lot of your work is done with this kit. You're gonna need a plastic spoon to stir everything up. You're gonna need your refill kit, which contains the ingredients that you're gonna be mixing up in the boiling hot water, and your instructions. All these things come with the kit. Next, you need a medium-sized saucepan and a can opener. Those are the only things you're gonna need from your own kitchen, with the exception of cold, clean water, which you're going to be adding later on. To sanitize your fermenter, you're going to put 1 gallon of warm water. There's a mark just below the lip here. You can lift it up to see. You can use tap water because it's going to be discarded. We are going to use the no-rinse cleanser that comes in the kit to create a sanitizing solution that we're going to put everything in that's going to possibly come into contact with the beer. Today we're making Prophecy Ale Basic. We've got maybe 40 different flavors in the store and just about every type of beer you can imagine. So, first thing, we've got the one-step no-rinse cleanser. You're going to use half the pack at this stage and half a pack later on. And you've got some additional sugar to increase the alcohol content, and then a canister of malted barley, hops, and water. That's all there is in it. No preservatives, no additives or colorants, and your brewer's yeast, which is going to go in last. So now we're going to start with the sanitizing. Okay, so we're going to do, like I said, half. We're going to do half of this packet. It doesn't have to be exact. That's about half. And we're going to set this aside and save it for the next step. Stir it all up. One thing you want to make sure is that the tap that's on your fermenting vessel is closed, because if it's open, you might find yourself pouring your sanitizing powder into an empty vessel. Can opener, I just dropped that in there. We might as well sanitize that too. This has now been sanitized. We're going to set this aside. I'm going to put the lid on and swish it all around to make sure the sanitizing solution touches all surfaces. Don't shake it too hard. You don't want any tools that are in there to scratch the inside surface. And make sure that you open this to run a little bit through the tap. Now we just set this down and leave it for 10 minutes and start warming up your ingredients. I've filled the sink with hot water. I'm just going to drop these guys in while the sanitizing process is going on. Meanwhile, we'll heat up a pot of water. I'm going to put 4 cups of water in a saucepan. Make sure you use filtered water and turn it on and get it up to a nice boil. Once your water is boiled, you can cover it up and turn it off. And we'll go and get the malt. Now that our fermenting container is ready and sanitized, I'm going to dump it out and set it on some clean paper towels that I have put right here. You don't rinse it, you just let it sit for a few minutes. Get all the liquid out. There we go. Next, we're going to get the malt and we're going to mix it into the water we boiled. So pouring in the malt. Try to get as much of the malt in there. This is the good stuff, and you want to scrape as much as you can out of the can. What I like to do is I take a couple spoonfuls of the hot mixture here and swirl it around to get any of the last little bits of malt that are stuck to the can, and pour that back in and scrape everything out. And we're going to pour in the booster, which is the other can that comes with your kit, and scrape everything out, and also put a little bit back in to swirl it around. The hot water helps loosen up what's left in there, get every last little bit of that deliciousness. The brewing enhancer is actually a booster. It's basically just a syrup to give you additional sugars to increase your alcohol content of your beer. You stir it all up to mix it in. Like I said before, this recipe has no added preservatives, no added colorants, nothing like that. It is very pure. It's just malted barley, hops, and water. Made in a craft brewery in New Zealand.
That's one of the great reasons to make your own beer, because the beer you buy at the store has all kinds of stuff that you have no idea.
It's as simple as that. Now we're ready to pour it into the fermenting container. So I've shaken off the excess water, I've made sure that the tap is closed, and now I'm going to pour the mixture.
And there we have it.
Now it's time to top up the mixture with cold filtered water. Up to the 2 gallon mark, which is marked right here on the map. The next step is to put the yeast in. That's called pitching the yeast. One thing that's really important is you want to put the yeast in when the temperature is between 64 and 82. So in this case, we're good, we're at 75, so we're ready. If your water's too hot, cover it with the lid and let it sit until it cools down. Don't leave the lid open for extended periods of time. You don't want anything getting in there. So here we go with the yeast. We'll just sprinkle that in. Don't worry if there's foam in there. Don't worry if the yeast clumps. You just want to get it in there. You don't have to stir it. Sometimes it's tempting to stir it, but the yeast is going to find the moisture and you'll find that after a few hours, it's gonna start moving the liquid around in there and it's gonna stir itself. Perfect. So now we're gonna set it somewhere shady to ferment for a week. There we have it. I'm gonna bring it over here. I don't wanna be by a window. I'm gonna set it right over here, out of the way, where we can keep an eye on it, but it's not gonna get any sunlight. And that is your first stage of fermentation, and we're going to come back to it in a week. Once the activity is completely stopped, we're going to bottle. So it's been a week. It's time. The fermentation process is done. The way I know is that I can see that there's really no more activity left. There's no more bubbling inside. But generally after a week, you can be pretty safe. The fermentation process is done. When we're bottling, one of the most important things in brewing is sanitation. Everything has to be absolutely as clean as possible. So we are going to take a gallon of water. You're going to need a container. I use an iced tea container. And all of this other equipment that you see here, the bottles, the tubing, the spoon, the no-rinse cleanser, and the bottle caps all come in the kit. The other thing that we're going to be using are sugar drops or carbonation drops. This does not come in the kit, but we sell them at the store too, or you can just use regular sugar. So, we're going to take the other half of the no-rinse cleanser, the other half of the packet. We used the first half already, and this is where the second half comes in. We're going to dump that into our gallon of cold water. It does not need to be hot water. And stir that in. The no-rinse cleanser is actually hydrogen peroxide, which is food safe. So once you drain it off and let it sit for a second, it evaporates away, so you don't have to worry about rinsing it off. That's why it's the no-rinse cleanser. This takes a minute or two to dissolve, and so while that's happening, I'm gonna take this opportunity to also sterilize the tubing that we're gonna use. This also came in the kit. We're gonna put that in there and make sure that's also nice and clean, both ends of it. Of course, my hands are very clean. We're gonna let that soak in there and I'll continue stirring. So most of that's dissolved and we're good to go. Now, let's put this into each of the bottles. You're gonna fill each one of these up halfway. Keep in mind we're making 2 gallons of beer and this is a gallon of no-rinse cleanser, so we're gonna put half a bottle in each one and there should be just the right amount. If you don't have an iced tea maker like this, you could just use a pitcher and a funnel and pour it in. The most important thing is to get about half a bottle's worth of no-rinse cleanser to sterilize each bottle. Okay, now that I've got them all filled up, we're going to cap them. I'm going to put the cap on. Down. And shake it up. That also sterilizes the inside of the cap. Every surface does need to be sterile. And once we've done that, for all 8 bottles, we're going to leave them all for 10 minutes to make sure the no-rinse cleanser has a chance to work its magic. And it wouldn't hurt to shake them again periodically during those 10 minutes. Our 10 minutes is up, and now we can dump out the no-rinse cleanser. It is no-rinse cleanser. They call it that for a reason. Don't be tempted to rinse it out because you'll introduce more bacteria into your beer. Just shake off all the excess cleanser, all the excess water that's left in there. Now that our bottles are ready to go, we're going to put priming sugar in for the secondary fermentation process. And what that means is primary fermentation was fermenting and using up all the sugars. The yeast consumed all the sugars in a fermenting vessel that was not sealed. All of the excess pressure was let out. So what we essentially have here is flat beer. When you transfer that into the bottles, we're going to put priming sugar in, which is going to give the yeast another food source so that they can get a little more fermentation done with the cap sealed. And with the cap sealed, that means that the carbonation has nowhere to go, the carbon dioxide has nowhere to go, and that is what gives us carbonated beer. So, in this case, we have 1-quart bottles. For 1 quart, you need 2.5 teaspoons of sugar, which is a little bit difficult to measure out. I happen to have here, these are carbonation drops, which are basically just sugar in 1 teaspoon pre-measured tablets, I guess. They're basically little cough drops almost. So we're going to use 2.5 of these for each one of these bottles. You can do this with a funnel if you're just using sugar. Regular sugar is just fine for this. But I love these drops because they're pre-measured and it makes it so much easier. Now it's time to fill them up with beer and cap them. All right, now that we're ready to bottle the beer, we're going to attach our spigot to our tube that we had previously sterilized. There's a pressure release on the bottom of this, and it will only release the beer when we push it against the bottom of the bottle. Here we go.
It smells so good. I can already smell it.
This is one of the things I love about this kit, is that this little dispensing wand, being able to connect it right to a tap, you don't have to create a siphon and use tubes and siphon it out of the top, which is what most traditional beer kits require you to do. The other thing I love, if you look at where the beer is coming out of the fermenter, all of the spent yeast has settled below the level of the tap. And that's a good thing. You don't want to catch this last little bit because it's full of yeast gunk and you don't want that in your beer. So because of the way this is built, we're automatically pouring off beer without getting any of the yeast troop, it's called. And here we put the cap on it. Screw this on real tight. Keep the gas in. The bottling is finished. It's time to clean the fermenter. That's the next step. Get it ready for the next batch. And here we have 8 1-quart bottles of beer ready to go into the garage or into the cabinet, the cupboard. Put it in a nice, cool, dark place. Not a place that's going to get too warm. You don't want it to complete its secondary fermentation too quickly. You might be tempted to shake these up to get the sugar drops to dissolve. You don't need to do that. Just let it sit. It'll dissolve on its own in no time. You're going to leave these in a cool, dark place for at least a week. And the way you tell it's done, take note of how it feels to squeeze the bottle. You can tell it's not carbonated. There's no pressure. And in about a week, 1 to 2 weeks, you're going to feel it's going to resist just like a bottle of soda. When you buy a bottle of soda and it's fully carbonated, you know what that feels like. So these bottles are going to start feeling like that in about a week. Once they feel that way, put them in the fridge and let them cool down and they'll be ready to drink.
And now for my favorite part, opening the beer and tasting.